run by my staff. So I'm gonna have my, the gal who runs my Fond du Lac office here, Sadie Parafenik, explain to you how we're gonna operate this, and then there'll be a test. So remember, her last name is Parafenik.
Hello, welcome. Like the congressman said, I'm Sadie Parafenik. I'm the deputy district director out of the Fond du Lac office, and really excited to be in Mount Calvary because I'm a Holy Lander. My parents are Vanderbilters over in Wolf Lake, so really happy to be here today. And how we've been running the town halls, as hopefully everybody signed in when they got here and filled out a card. If you didn't, just raise your hand and we'll have somebody give one to you. And I'll be randomly drawing and saying, calling your name, and then you'll have the opportunity to ask the question, and then the congressman can respond, and then we'll just try to keep things moving to get as many questions as we can. Anybody we don't get to today, we will take them back to the office and have somebody respond to you. So that's the rundown.
Okay, very good. I'll start off by giving you a little bit of update as far as what's going on in Washington. Maybe tell you some things that I don't know whether you've heard or not on the news, and we'll go through the questions. And if there are not enough questions, I'll think of other things to do until 4 o'clock. I can't hang around too late because I've got another one of these in Beaver Dam coming up. Okay, this is my second term in Congress. You know, when we started out, I had the same committee assignments I did last time, which are good committees because they're committees I asked for. And most of the time in Washington is spent in committees, not on the floor. You'll always see us on the floor. I'm on the Education and Workforce Committee, which deals with both labor law and education of all sorts, be it K-12 education, university education, technical school education, what have you. I'm also on Government Oversight, which deals with scandals. That was a very busy committee for about the first 5 months of the year. I don't know if you look like a C-SPAN junkie, but Jason Chaffetz was the chairman of that committee, and he was there. It was probably the most active committee there. He surprised us all by quitting early, and I haven't seen him yet. Is he on Fox? So our new chairman is kind of getting up and running, so it hasn't been a busy since then, trading out from South Carolina. The other committee I'm on is the Budget Committee, which is a very important committee. We'll talk about it in a little bit. It doesn't fill in the details of the budget, but it does set the overall parameters. My chairman there is a woman by the name of Diane Black. Okay.
A little louder, please.
Okay, I'm sorry. As far as what's going on in the individual committees, and if I begin to, don't be afraid to raise your hand and say speak up later, because we don't have a microphone today. I was hoping the room would be small enough. You can all hear me, but like I said, if you're in the back, you can't hear me, don't be afraid to raise your hand and say speak up again. First thing I'm going to talk a little bit about is the budget committee. You know, there's been a lot of focus on the state budget and not enough focus on the federal budget. I'm a little bit disappointed in the budget so far. We haven't voted on the overall parameters on the budget. I think I've had some influence, but of course the country is very in debt. It's $20 trillion in debt, and I don't really feel that Congress has the appropriate sense of urgency on that budget right now. And so you understand, $20 trillion, that's about $60,000 for every man, woman, and child in the country. So you have a family of four, that's $240,000 in debt. And that's not actuarial debt when they talk about your liabilities for future Social Security. That's debt right now. So obviously, Congress shouldn't be spending so much money. Congress only every year votes on about 30% of that budget. 70% of that budget is what they call mandatory spending. Some of that mandatory spending is things that you paid your whole life for, like Social Security and Medicare. Other of that mandatory spending is things that people get under current law if they fill out a government form, things that we'd sometimes refer to as welfare related. That's also mandatory spending and chugs on every year, even if Congress doesn't vote for any of them. And if, let's say, you have a government shutdown, that 70% continues going ahead. On the other 30%, historically, about half was military and half was non-military. Earlier this year, we voted on an omnibus bill, which I voted against because it did spend too much money, but an omnibus bill that in essence funded the government through September 30th. And in that bill, they did break away from that tradition and we're spending more on the military than other things. On the budget for the year beginning October 1st, which is really the first budget that Donald Trump will be dealing with, He did what he could to try to put the brakes on spending a little. He wanted to increase military spending by 5.5%. I was in favor of that. If any, you know anybody in the military, they'll tell you stories. Lack of spare parts for the airplanes, you know, need more equipment for the ships and this sort of thing. So I was in favor of that. He tried to offset that with a corresponding cut in non-military spending. And I think holding things even would be appropriate. We, of course, get more income tax revenue every year as the economy grows. We've got to work our way towards a balanced budget. I thought Congress behaved irresponsibly after that. While we do need more military spending, over 100 Republican congressmen sent a letter saying they wanted an increase of over 11%. Well, 11% is a lot. I know somebody who I trust who felt the military wouldn't even know to do to absorb that big of an increase so quickly. So I was one of the people who fought that and held the total to 9.5%. I really think 9.5% is more than enough. We did wind up passing an appropriation bill with a 9.5% increase in there. I had an amendment to cut it by 1%. And the way things work in Congress, leadership does not always give you a chance to vote on every amendment. There's a committee on the Rules Committee that determines that. There was a guy, a Democrat from Colorado, who had an identical amendment. They decided to put his amendment to the vote. And what called the Rules Committee, they didn't even allow that amendment. So we wound up voting out of the House a bill increasing military spending by about 9.5%. One of the good things there is we haven't been giving our troops an appropriate raise for a while, so we give a little bit of raise to the troops. That's a good thing. Nevertheless, it was a little bit higher than I would have thought. As far as the rest of the budget is concerned, Congress would not cut the rest of the budget by the 6.5% or 7% that Donald Trump wanted. They cut it by about 1.2%. And we voted on a combined bill. They threw the rest of that military bill, the non-military bill, together last week, and we voted it out. I was really mixed as to whether to vote for or against that bill. I was glad we had a cut of about 1.2% in non-military, and I was glad that we had an increase in military, but quite frankly, neither parts of those bill was as low as it should be. There were 10 cutting amendments to that bill. I had 3 of the 10. And it was probably as active as anybody is trying to hold down the overall level of spending. But my amendments didn't pass. There were other people who had cutting amendments as well. There were like 10 cutting amendments, none of them passed. As a practical matter, what I'm seeing is when you try to rein in spending, usually, and I think I get along with the Democrats very well, but usually you don't get any Democrats vote for cutting spending. And usually you're always going to get 70 to 100 of the 240 Republicans saying that they're going to not vote for any cut in spending. So it's very difficult to get cuts in spending there. But in any event, that's where we are with regard to the appropriation bills, is what you folks may refer to as the budget. It's now up to the Senate to do something. We believe, and it's a little bit irresponsible of them, that the Senate will not lay out a position of where they stand on the overall level of spending. We believe what's going to happen is the Senate will say, let's work on a deal and we won't go public with what our position is, and we'll probably vote on something called an omnibus bill in December, which I don't like, but that's the type of bill that has everything under the sun under it, including policy that you may like, that you may not like. It's the type of bill where there's so many things in it that you really have a hard time as a congressman even finding out how much is in there before they have a vote on this. But I think that is how we are going to deal with the year that begins October 1st. And you'll notice by voting for that at Christmas, it means we're not voting for the budget or voting to spend money until about 2.5 months into the year, which is irresponsible as well. The next committee I'm on is the Education and Workforce Committee. We did pass an important bill out of there that is in the Senate. Right now, I think you'd have to say we have too many people getting college degrees in fields in which they're not getting jobs. And that's a huge problem. Meanwhile, we have a lack of people with skills. You know, we had a job fair over in Fond du Lac about a month ago now, and I was talking to some of the guys for trade schools, the pipe trades, the operating engineers. They can't find enough people to fill these positions. And they're very good positions in the pipe trades. People are making over $100,000 a year. But in all these areas, as well as if you talk to people in the tech school, you find people going back 27, 28, 29 years old, find the learning skills, they can get a good family supporting job, And meanwhile, they had a college diploma, maybe they ran up $40,000-$50,000 in debt, and they're not beginning to make the type of money you should be making to pay off such a debt. So we did what we could, and so far as the federal government weighs in, it's not really up to the federal government to micromanage things, but insofar as we can weigh in to provide more flexibility for states to kind of aim at more skills-based education. So we do, we are able to fill these jobs, and so we don't have so many people going with general college degree, in which they wind up with debt and nothing to show for. The other thing we're going to look at in that committee is I do want to look at the student loan problem. And, you know, you run into people. I'm sure you, some of you know of kids, grandkids, way big debts. I was at one of these meetings a couple months ago. A couple came up to me, between the two of them, they were over $100,000 in debt. They're in their early 30s. I mean, how are they ever going to, you know, buy a house, have children, that sort of thing? So we've got to do something. I have two amendments I'm going to try to put in that bill, one of which I believe has a good chance of passing. The other won't pass yet, but sometimes you throw an idea out there, and that idea maybe becomes law in 10 or 12 years, but I want people to think about it. The thing I would like to do is I'd like to say that before somebody takes out a loan, they've got to have that educational institution sign off. I hear when I talk to some people who run the educational institutions, that sometimes students take out more debt than they need. And I understand that because that happened when I went to college 40 years ago. Yes, I did. Okay, that happened 40 years ago, in which sometimes people take out a big loan and they use it for lifestyle. You know, maybe they take, you know, a nice trip in spring, maybe they have a car or something like that. I would like it if the universities themselves or tech schools had to sign off and say, we believe that this student needs this amount of money. The other thing I'd like to do is I'd like to have the universities on the hook for some of the loan itself. Even if it's only 10%, when I ran into somebody that's, you know, $50,000 in debt and they're, you know, they're making $20,000 a year, somebody screwed up or gave some bad advice there. And I think if the universities themselves were responsible for maybe 10% of the debt, they'd be paying a little bit more attention. They'd be, make a little bit more certain that their students had some sort of internship when they were going through school. Maybe they'd be paying a little more attention as to what the major of that student is. Maybe they'd be paying a little more attention as to whether that student could even get a degree. Because a lot of times, of course, these kids take out big student debts and don't even graduate. Maybe they'd say, hey, wait a minute, look at your test scores. We don't think you'll make it. And if they did that, maybe we wouldn't have these big loans in the first place. The other committee we're on is the Government Oversight Committee. We recently had another hearing on Fast and Furious. If you're familiar with Fast and Furious is, that was something that took place during the Obama administration, in which American guns were funneled entirely inappropriately. I think they were trying to create a situation in which there was a feeling that American guns were going into Mexico and resulting in crime down there, but it was actually the American government that was behind it. It's a huge scandal. I hope we're still able to do something with that. So that's what's going on in my three committees. I'm going to comment briefly on Obamacare, because that was kind of a disappointment. People wanted to get rid of Obamacare. I think Obamacare is a huge problem for the country. Over time, you're going to find a huge percentage of counties in this country are only going to be able to offer one insurer under Obamacare. If they're only offering one insurer, they've got a monopoly. You know the cost is going to continue to spiral up. There are going to be some counties without any health insurance coverage at all. One of the problems we've had is it's hard to get congressmen to vote for something that's not 100% what they want, only 80% of what they want, or 70% of what they want. I voted for two replacement plans for Obamacare, one that had to go through the budget committee, the other one was on the floor of the House, so we did eventually get something out of the House. The Senate, as you know, has not been able to do anything at this point. I'm a little bit frustrated, not a little bit, I'm very frustrated with Senator McConnell. I happen to be hanging around the Senate, and so you know I think one of the big problems in Congress is the House members and the senators don't meet anywhere near enough. I was in the state legislature first, and when I was in the state legislature, the senators and assemblymen hung around all the time. I think your assemblyman is Jesse Kramer and your senator is Dewey Stroh. And I'm sure they see each other all the time. You're in the Capitol, they walk back and forth in the rotunda, they go out to dinner forever. In Washington, I could spend a week and never see a U.S. senator. The senator's on the north side of the building, the congressman on the south side of the building. At the end of the day, the congressman walked further south, the senators walked further north. We don't necessarily see each other. But in any event, on that night, because I thought it might be a little bit historic, I figured I'd go over to the Senate and watch the vote. And apparently John McCain had told people a couple hours before the vote that he was going to vote to repeal Obamacare. He changed his mind. I know Mike Pence was talking to him, you know, right before the vote. The thing that frustrated me, though, was that when John McCain voted no, he said he was voting no for a reason. Not that he wanted to keep Obamacare. He said he wanted a Congressional Budget Office estimate, and he wanted a committee hearing, which, given it was kind of a placeholder bill, I don't think he had to ask for that, but he did ask for it. If you were Mitch McConnell and really wanted that bill to pass, what would you do? When it failed, you'd say, okay, we'll give it to John McCain, we'll give you your committee hearing, we'll get a Congressional Budget Office estimate, and then we're going to have another vote in September. He didn't do that. Instead, Mitch McConnell got up and said he was completely brokenhearted. He wanted so badly to repeal Obamacare. You know, everybody worked so hard, but now we have to move on. Oh, wait a minute. That's not what you'd say if you really want to end it, right? Okay. So it was a little bit frustrating. I didn't think he was, that sincere. I did happen to attend a meeting with Ron Johnson yesterday, and he had some good news in that, surprising us, he felt they could maybe get to 50 votes in the Senate with a different sort of repeal next week when I go back. I should say next week, a week from Monday when I go back. So you understand this job? I spent, in an average month, I spent 3 weeks here, maybe touring factories, educational institutions, hospitals, that sort of thing, or meeting with people in my Fond du Lac office. And the fourth week I spent 3 weeks in Washington and 1 week doing that. And this week coming up is the week I'll be in Fond du Lac or running around the district doing meetings. But the following week, we will be back, and Ron Johnson is surprisingly optimistic, though I haven't seen the details, that they are going to get something out of the Senate the final week in September, so we'll have to wait and see. As far as the tax reform, that's another thing that is supposed to be a priority. The House of Representatives has a plan out that I'm not thrilled with. My concern with the plan is, I think it is aimed too much at, I hate to say rich, but you wind up taxing investment income at half the rate of working income. I do not see how you can justify saying that if I'm living off interest income in a bank, that I pay tax at half the rate of somebody who's working, you know, third shift as a nurse, as a welder, as a truck driver or something. That just doesn't seem right. I was glad to see about 6 weeks ago Donald Trump weigh in, and he felt the plan also had to be more aimed at the middle class. So hopefully we'll get something like that out, and hopefully it will be aimed more at the middle class. I also think that we should see if more people pay some tax. And right now in the plan, they want to increase the zero bracket amount so more people are paying no tax at all. I think we all benefit by the government. We all have the benefit of the armed services. We have the benefit of the national parks. And it's not good if half the people aren't paying any tax at all. It could be a low rate, but it's good if people pay something. But I think we also have to focus on the middle class. So that's, in general, my opinion on that. As far as welfare is concerned, which is what I ran on, I do believe right now we're discouraging people from work and discouraging people from getting married due to the perverse incentives of a wide variety of welfare-related programs. I am hoping we do something like that this year. I am not overwhelmingly optimistic. I have told Paul Ryan this is something we have to do many times, and some months he's optimistic, and once he even said, I've decided to agree with Glenn Groth, got to take up welfare right now. But it's going to take the Senate going along as well. We have to go through something called a reconciliation process in which the Senate and House agree to pass a budget resolution in which we can do things with 51 votes in the Senate instead of 60 votes. I do not know whether we're going to get the Senate to go along with that. I'm going to strongly encourage Paul Ryan to hold out for that. I don't know whether he will or not. I'll digress, and Kirsten, we didn't cover one other thing. One of the reasons we do not get more done in Washington is for most bills, it requires 60 votes in the Senate. You know, there are 100 senators, and every other elected body I'm familiar with, you know, the Fond-du-Lac County Board, the Village Board of Mount Calvary, the state legislature, the U.S. Congress, if you have a majority, that bill passes. In the U.S. Senate, it usually takes 60 votes. There are exceptions only on a given number of issues, but it's much more difficult to get 60 out of 100 senators to vote for something instead of just 51 out of 100. And part of that is it means we have to have 8 Democrats sign off too, which means the practical matter, Chuck Schumer has to sign off. And obviously, to get Chuck Schumer to sign off, there are a lot of things philosophically. He will not want to do that, and that's one of the reasons why things are delayed. We have got many bills out of the House, been very productive. We actually got a bill to the President with regard to VA reform. It's going to make it easier to get rid of a bad employee in the VA, which is something we should have done a long time ago. We weren't able to get that bill under Barack Obama, but I was glad we were able to get that bill signed under Donald Trump. We have many other bills reducing the amount of regulation. We have gotten out of the House some of the bills dealing with new regulations that Barack Obama put in effect. Not long after he left office, we were able to pass the 51 votes out of the Senate as well. So we've done a lot. There are just a couple of high-profile things that are giving us, rightfully so, a bad reputation, and that we have not yet dealt with tax reform, we've not yet dealt with Obamacare, and we haven't dealt with welfare reform. And when we eventually wind up passing the omnibus bill in December, I will guarantee you it will be too big spending. And it is because we have a big increase in military, and they weren't willing to go down to non-military. And that's why we had such big spending during George Bush years. So I was going up in the military, they have to throw the Democrats and say, well, let us go up in the military. They'll say, sure, but we want a big increase in non-military too, and you wind up with a mess. So there is a little bit of an overview of what's going on, and now we're going to turn to Sadie Parafinic, and she's going to give me questions.
Gary Schoenbeck, so you
want to
answer your question?
Well, it's not so much a question, it's a concern. It's the DOL fiduciary role.
Yes.
I've been a registered security director for 26 years, and it's really been extremely damaging to the whole security business, and it's definitely going to limit the amount of advice that small investors who need good quality advice. They're going to be very limited in who's going to be able to deal with them. I won't deal with them anymore because I can't afford to.
Right.
If you want a business and you want to go do something, you're going to lose money doing it. You aren't going to do it.
Right. Particularly people without a lot of money set aside.
And I have a lot of small investors now, but I won't be able to do it going forward if that rule stays in place.
Right. And this is an example of a rule that we cannot deal with in Congress without 60 votes in the Senate. You know, we passed a bill that I co-sponsored out of the House of Representatives. Yep, we passed that. We had several hearings trying to highlight the founder's role in the Education and Workforce Committee. I have met with the Department of Labor, and they feel they are doing as much as they can do under current law to delay implementation of that rule. They are afraid if they outright appeal the rule that they will lose in court. So what they are asking for, and you may even help there, is they are asking for more specific examples from professionals such as yourself as to why it's a bad rule. They felt they were getting a lot of anecdotal evidence from folks such as you, but they were getting specifics as far as bad actors from the other side. But we met with them, and they feel that under the Trump administration, the Department of Labor is doing as much as they legally can do, and they are trying to delay things to give more opportunity to people, literally saying specifically, here is somebody I will not help out of the future. So I'm doing as much as I can, given the law, which goes back 40 years.
Susan Wilson? Amy? This morning, in one of his usual tweet storms, Donald Trump tweeted a gif of himself at a Hillary Clinton
in the back of the golf ball. And also mocking Kim Jong-un, which is a very dangerous, childish approach to the North Korean problem. I don't consider this or any of his tweets acceptable behavior for a 9-year-old, much less the president of the United States. Do you support the embarrassing behavior of the commander-in-chief?
I have only had one conversation with Donald Trump since he won the election. And that conversation was maybe 2 minutes on the outside. So I had to think what I'm going to tell Donald Trump in my 1 or 2 minutes. I told him he's tweeting too much. And I was very, very blunt. It is important that Donald Trump be a success because only he is going to solve the immigration problem in this country. Only he is going to have the guts to work towards a balanced budget. I think, as I mentioned here, regulatory agencies are doing a good job. But he is just plain wrong on these tweets. And I looked at it this morning, actually, and it was embarrassing. You know, what was he thinking of? You know, and it hurts his whole agenda, his popularity. I think it would be 9 or 10 points higher if he would be a little bit more professional on Twitter. So what I'll tell you, if I meet him again, I'll tell him again. I have a question to meet with him. There are 435 congressmen, and I haven't had a chance with him in quite a while. Before I left Washington on Thursday, there was a guy by the name of Chris Collins, who was an early backer of Donald Trump, who wanted to get together some congressmen to advise him routinely, and he asked me whether I'd be part of the group. I don't think it'll come of it, but if something does come of it, I'll bring it up right away. And you're absolutely right. You know, it's very frustrating to see him do that. And I saw it this morning. I thought we were over that.
Thank you. Emily Matthews?
I had concerns about your support for the proposed NOAA sanctuary in Lake Michigan. Given the history of what happened in Lake Huron, I'm alarmed at this proposal. The 1972 Act regarding NOAA mentioned nothing to do with shipwrecks, and it does mention, it's all about prohibiting development, shall we say. So we lose local control of 1,260 square miles of Lake Michigan. The possession in terms of the sanctuary would be irreversible. They could expand it. In Huron, it began with 440 square miles. It's now 4,300 square miles. They could start to impose restrictions on our commercial fishing, the Badger Ferry, the charter fishing, all the tourism that we currently have and the access we currently have. The state of Wisconsin is doing an excellent job of protecting the shipwrecks, which is the purported reason for this, but really, it's my understanding that the federal government covets Lake Michigan and they want to increase their stranglehold on the states through this. I would be concerned about buffer zones expanding. The years ago proposed Fox Wisconsin Parkway was another federal proposal to take over a large part of Wisconsin. It was supposed to be from the, you know, Lake Winnebago, you know, Fox, Wisconsin, the rivers and stuff. You know where, how far their buffer zone reached? New Holstein. That's an awful lot of farmland that they could then just decide that people couldn't farm anymore. I know for a fact that in Lake Huron, in 12 years, they have not increased jobs, they have not increased tourism, it has not helped the economy. And there was a person who was on a jet ski who got in trouble. He didn't know he was over the prohibited area. Some people in a boat came to rescue this man, save him from drowning, and both the jet skier and the rescuers got fined thousands of dollars. And NOAA said, well, if you try to fight it, you won't win, and we're going to charge you the same amount every day that you don't pay this fine. So they just had to pay this, I don't know how many tens of thousands fine that they had to pay. I don't think that you were given all the information when you expressed support for this, and I would like you to retract your support officially for this proposal, because I don't see that it's going to benefit our state at all, and it will just be be one more encroachment of the federal government.
I don't anticipate any votes in the near future on NOAA. I had asked people.
It's not votes. It was just, see, they can't come in unless they're invited, and you and a bunch of other politicians were only told part of the picture and expressed support. So what needs to happen now is the people that express support need to publicly say, we withdraw this.
Right.
It's not a congressional vote thing. It's worse
right.
than that.
What I'm looking for from people in this group, and I'd love it if you would give me your help on this, and of course it includes not only Lake Michigan, but it could include the oceans as well, is some specific amendments that I can slide in somewhere to restrict the federal power. And clarify that they would not have too much.
Well, unfortunately, this isn't really a legislative issue. What they do is they will pick target groups like historical societies or something, and then get them all going rah, 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 and in favor of it without knowing all the details. And then it's like, as it were, Wisconsin's inviting them to come in. So it's unfortunately not a congressional legislative thing, but just the very fact that different congressmen or governor, different politicians have expressed support, that is alarming to me, because then no one can say, well, see, we can march right in. They're all in favor of it.
Well right, that's what I mean. I want, in the future, if they ever do get here, it be clarified that there's a lot of things they can't do. But I'd like to talk to you afterwards about it one more time, and there was a big meeting that I wasn't able to make, but my staff made over at Sheboygan County, and I would like to talk to you later.
Okay, I cannot read this, so I apologize, but it is from Schumacher Lane in Malone.
Schumacher Lane?
Yes.
That's from
Dave Schumacher Lane?
Yes. Dave.
I've got a question about ethanol. I don't know if it's a state issue or a federal issue, but there's a lot of states that you have to buy ethanol, period. You can't get it out of there. And I just don't want it raised. Some states are talking about raising ethanol more than it is now.
I don't think the state of Wisconsin is going to do that. There was a bill out there at one time when I was the state legislature, like, good grief, it was 10 years ago now that I voted against. But I haven't heard that bill moving in the state legislature again. I think given the current makeup, it would not move. I think over time we're seeing more 15% ethanol, but that's entirely by choice. That's not something forced on you. I've been told that Quick Trip is having 15% ethanol, a choice, not something you have to buy, a choice in their gas station. At least I checked a couple when I filled up there. They do have that option, but that's not something that's going to be forced on anybody.
It's no question about it. It's no good for engines. It's devastating on small engines.
On small engines, and there are a lot of gas stations, not a lot, but there are gas stations out there that you can buy gas that has no ethanol in it. And it's not going to change. I don't know anybody who's trying to force a change like that.
I got another question on Roundup. Now, they banned it in California. There's no question about it. It causes cancer. And I'm against Roundup, period.
Okay.
Hi, my name is Brad Demo. I'm going to try to run through this quickly, but first I just want to say thank you for, one, being here, and two, for leading the way on student loan reform. As a young person, that's an issue that's going to impact me, so thank you so much for that. So I'm 17 years old. I'm a junior in high school. I live in Oshkosh. So as a young person, I remember my family struggling to pay for healthcare costs. My mother stayed home, so my dad was self-employed, so we had coverage through the individual market. But it was something that people would refer to as junk insurance. There were, you know, lifetime caps, annual caps, and no essential health benefits guaranteed. So when I was 8 and I had to have eye surgery, I couldn't go to the doctor when I had the flu in the fall. because otherwise I'd have my parents have to pay $200 out of pocket to see the doctor, and it's not like they could just give me medication and make the flu better. So I've also had acid reflux and anxiety all my life. And in December, I started having chest pain and heavy breathing. But at that point, after the Affordable Care Act passed, we were able to get a plan that guaranteed emergency room care. So my mom was able to take me to the emergency room, and it wasn't anxiety, it wasn't chest pain, it was something called myopericarditis. I don't know if anyone's a cardiologist here, but I spent a week in the ICU at Children's Hospital in Milwaukee, just a few more hours, and they would have to poke a needle in my heart. So I'm just wondering, as someone who, through the Affordable Care Act, was able to access emergency room care, this is an issue dear to my heart, literally. So why did you vote yes on a plan that would allow states to get waivers on those lifetime and annual caps?
I don't think under that plan you would ever have a situation in which a state would, as a practical matter, deny coverage for emergency room coverage. First of all, no emergency room could turn you down anyway, but you're right, the cost could be very high. But there are examples when you put mandates on an insurance company where you could have something out there that some people may not want to pay for. In other words, if your parents are shopping in the individual market, you may say, I'd rather save $400 a year by not going for this coverage than going for coverage that you yourself feel you probably wouldn't need. I cannot conceive of any individual state saying we're not going to cover emergency room coverage or something. It just strains credibility to think that will happen. Now, you can say that states are free to do that, but what state would do that? I mean, it's saying that I have a heart problem and my health insurance isn't going to cover a heart problem if I'm going to the emergency room. It's just not credible that would ever happen. It is true that I think for certain things, maybe for certain pharmaceutical coverages, certain mental health coverages, if in the future the nature of health insurance changes and your parents want to check up, I'm going to cover this, not cover that, and you, your parents feel it would save you something not to cover some things, I think that's the right they should have. Because right now, health insurance is very expensive. Now, I do think they ought to focus more on the overall cost of health care, because that's the big problem, whether you're shopping the individual market, whether you're the government trying to provide Medicaid or Medicare, whether you're a company trying to provide insurance for your employees, that is the overall problem. And I don't think Congress has addressed the problem the degree to which they should. I think if something becomes of this new plan that Ron Johnson is talking about, and they're going to be sending a lot of money back to the states and, you know, seeing what the states can do, and I think kind of through experimentation, maybe some of the states will be able to hold the line on health insurance. But I really don't see a day coming in which people are going to offer health insurance and say, we're not going to cover emergency coverage. That's just not, in the real world, that's not believable, I guess I'll put it there.
Okay. I hope you'll lead a bipartisan way forward to keep the cost down while keeping the infections.
Right.
So thank you.
Right.
Nick Tepke?
I didn't have a question.
Oh, all right. Jeff Reese.
Yes, Congressman. I am here to talk about infrastructure. I'd like, first of all, to thank you for your support in the long distance enterprise service. It's really, it's important to have other means of getting around. Our highways are getting too congested. People got no time like to fly. And since
I'm not sure people don't like to fly. Whenever I'm on the airplane, they've never been busy. But that's your experience. that's your experience.
Well, maybe the wind is too high. I don't know. That could be. But since you have three Amtrak stops within your district, maybe about most of would it be possible to have a dedicated service between Chicago and 27th, so you could go from between the two places and get back in the same day?
Well, my guess would be that right now, and I haven't looked, next time I'm here, I'll look, my guess would be there are tons of airline flights between the Twin Cities and Chicago. And I think that given the huge number of airline flights between Chicago and the Twin Cities, my guess would be that since a train would almost inevitably take much longer than that, that the number of people who want to take the train to Chicago from Twin Cities would be tiny.
But then you've got the people that are, let's say they're in Madison, they want to catch a train out of Columbus. I mean, that's not realistic. I mean, most people travel.
And I'll just deal with that example. You're saying, if I want to go by train from Madison to the Twin Cities, through Columbus, so now I got a choice. I can either take a plane from Madison to the Twin Cities, or I can drive to Columbus, which is a half hour away, to get on a train, which is going to be slower than an airplane, to go from Columbus to the Twin Cities. I just don't think that's going to happen. I think there already is a train. It's still there. And my guess is the number of people in Madison, if they have to pick between driving their own car or taking a plane out of the Madison airport or driving a half hour to Columbus and getting on a train in Columbus, I bet a distant third is driving to get a train in Columbus.
You probably, let's say you want to do some work between two places, and so you've got your computer, your laptop. Can't work it in the car, but you can do some work while you're on the train.
Well, next time, I don't get any heat track of this, but next time I talk to somebody from the DOT, I will see if they know whether how many people take the train, how many people take the plane, and how many people are driving. But I thank you for your question.
Harold Bartnick?
Yes, here. I'm concerned about the collisions in the naval ships that are first line of missile defense out there. It's very expensive. There aren't that many of these ships, and to have them run into with all the nav aids they have.
It's kind of amazing, isn't it?
It's expensive.
It's expensive, and we rely on our military, and if they're running into other ships up there, you gotta wonder. I mean, I wonder. I know the Armed Services Committee is looking at it. I do believe Congress has not been skeptical enough with regard to the people who are running our military. And maybe I can get the chairman of my committee, I said government oversight, to look at it, but through the Armed Services Committee, we should be primarily concerned. They're always asking for all this money. And like I said, I bet by the time they're done, they're going to get a 9% increase in their budget. And if they have a bunch of people who, I mean, obviously you got to have people at the top who are on the ball. And I hope we don't need to use our military, but they've got to be ready. And the incompetence concerns me. And I will ask my staff when I get back to, if they're not going to have a hearing on that in Armed Services, to find exactly what's going on. Maybe they're promoting the wrong people. Maybe they're promoting people for the wrong reason. But it just shouldn't happen. It's ridiculous.
They said a large part of the fleet is not passing certification out there.
And they'll always say they need more money. And like I said, we're going to give them a 9% increase. But if you talk to people in the military, they also feel we're wasting money. So hopefully we have a new emphasis on who winds up running our armed services under our new president, and hopefully things will improve. But I will specifically ask Trey Gowdy when I get back to, if the armed services is not having a public hearing on this, to do it on the government oversight committee that I'm on.
Robert Benishet.
First off, Congressman Brokaw, I'll ask you to look at the side of the matter. what age, that's all it's roughly as possible.
There's one another week, you're right.
Yeah, so, I get old since then. My question is just if you could speak to the Graham Cassidy Heller ECA repeal that been proposed in the Senate, which maybe is what Johnson is
talking. Right, that's what he's talking about. And I'm not sure what the final details are going to be. I think we are at a position in which something is going to have to be done. If we would have held this meeting a week ago, I would have guessed at the end the Senate would just put more money into Obamacare, delay it for 2 years, and say, look at what we've done. And the fact that Senator Johnson is implying that this would move was kind of a surprise to me when I met with him, I guess yesterday. And I'm not going to comment on it because I haven't looked at the details because it surprises me that it's moving so fast, or may move so fast. You know, maybe there's just a rumor and I'll get back to Washington and I'll be like, what do you mean? It's going nowhere. But assuming what he was telling me, it was somewhat surprising the broad-based support it has in the Senate. Like it could get 50 votes, including people who I don't think would have guessed would vote for it.
Thank you.
So we're in a unique position, and that was the last question anybody had. I do have the cards of the people who didn't write a question, so I could go through and pick some names, and if you thought of a question.
Yeah, well, should we just open it up? Should I just say if anybody?
Yeah. Anybody who hasn't had a chance to talk yet?
We'll take the guy in the back.
I'd like to know what your feeling is on Medicare for All.
Well, what you mean is, in essence, the government providing health care for everybody. And
well, wouldn't it wouldn't it be just the government paying the doctor if the person goes to it? I don't see where anything gets complicated there. Okay, now I'm done.
Okay. Medicare for All really does mean, or working towards, the government providing health care for everybody. And everywhere else in our society, America is a wealthy country and the envy of the world because of the free market system. There are two areas in which I think you could say we're spending too much of our overall dollars for something, or the share of your income is going up surprisingly a lot in the last 20 years. One is education, college costs, and the other is medical care. And those are two things that the government is very, very involved in. Other things, costs are falling. And even in medical care, on things the government doesn't get involved in, like cosmetic surgery, the cost falls. So when you say I want the government to, in essence, get a lot more involved in medical care, what you're saying is the system that provides us with such choice on any other thing you would buy isn't going to work on the most important thing, or almost the most important thing you buy, and that is medical. And that's why I'm not for Medicare for everybody. Now we'll jump on the blue.
Yeah. Of course, the Affordable Care Act is a step toward government medical care for everybody. It's a step toward that direction.
Right.
Because people just can't simply afford to buy private insurance. Pay scale is what it's done. You worked hard on lowering the pay scale when you're in the state senate. You worked really hard on that. When Walker went out and accused the public employees union that the state debt at $3 billion was a problem, you went along and backed Walker against the public state employees union, primarily the teachers union. And now Walker instantaneously has got $3 billion for a foreign investment in Foxconn, Taiwan outfit. And the Taiwan, if you read the Milwaukee Journal, Taiwan outfit is going to build a factory in China. So workers in Wisconsin are going to compete with China. I'm buying flat screens. And that's all. Who needs a flat screen?
Well, with regard to health care, what was your initial comment on the health care problem?
Oh, but the other thing is, on this year of Medicare, Medicare applies to a lot of students, and you went up to the hill with Trump, and you had a big junket. And then later, Trump says it was mean, the Paul Ryan plan. You were along with the Ryan plan, and Trump said it was mean. So I think one thing nice about Trump, he's able to lead guys like you and Ryan out on a limb, and he saws it off on you. And you're like, what do you do about that? Well, isn't that kind of like sitting on the fence and
swearing? I will say this. We have got to find a way to make medical costs less. Individual businesses, I think, are doing a good job if they're sizable enough to provide health care for 800 to 1,000 people. And I think the combination of employer-based clinics, HSAs, they are able to provide medical care for a lot less than you would have to if you were buying an individual market. The thing is how to duplicate that for more employees. Scott Walker had tried to self-insure for the state of Wisconsin this time around. As you know, that was shot down in the state legislature. But I do believe that if you let the free market work and you even have consortiums of smaller employers, I think you do have the ability to cut health care costs. And if you could cut health care costs overall in this country by 20 to 25%, you'd probably be solved. And individual employers, if they have a chunk of employees, are able to do that.
I don't think that's going to work. And block grants is not going to work either.
Just a comment on everybody getting excited about this health care. If you paid a plumber through a third party, don't you think his cost would go up? If you paid an electrician through a third party, wouldn't that cost go up? All we need is major medical for the ER visits, for the big things. And there is a group of doctors now that are opting out of insurance, hence their costs are lower. It's called the Wedge of Health Freedom. So if anybody's concerned about that, they can check out the website, the Wedge of Health Freedom.
Thank you.
Now there were a couple other people who we didn't catch. Yes.
I try to understand what the hesitance is holding up health care across state lines. You know, it seems like that word is the big push when we're really trying to make some changes to health care, and yet that seems to die on the line.
I'm guessing to a certain extent, if you look at the Senate, the number of people who won't vote for appeal for Obamacare, it's the same crew. I think if there's a problem, there may be a concern that you should look out for people, and maybe people will buy an insurance policy from some other state with low standards. That's all I can think of. The benefit, so you can understand, of buying across state lines is kind of the opposite of what the gentleman in the blue wanted, and that is, or kind of what you're telling me too. You should have the ability to buy health insurance only for the things that you want insurance for. And individual states will not necessarily allow that. You are right. Yes?
Prescription costs. My wife is at the villa for 8 months and is getting a drug. Four capsules each day, $13,700 a month. Being paid by Medicaid. You finally discontinued it. Doesn't seem to be making a difference, but just that figure, $13,700 a month.
There's no question the government ought to do what they can to rein in prescription drug costs. And I'm not sure the individual medication your wife is getting, but when they brought in the executives who were overcharging on these EpiPens, I was very vocal with that. And we did get them to back off, but we can't do that on a case-by-case basis. Overall, I have a problem with the pharmaceutical industry. I think individual drugs are overcharged, and I think we're overdrugged as a society.
You need to develop that stuff to happen, like you're paid to be able to cover overhead, it's all profit. But we are
the number of drugs we take in this country compared to other countries is very high. And it's hard to argue that we are not. Is that true?
Yeah.
Or medicated, yeah. Mm-hmm. That's a problem throughout the whole medical. Okay. What? We've got a guy with a camera.
Yeah. I have a question.
Who are you with, by the way? I didn't ask you.
What? Sir?
Who are you with, by the way?
I'm with Badger Eye?
Okay.
Okay. Would you support a bill to codify DACA and protect 800,000 young people from deportation?
No. I think...
Yeah, why?
You are creating a situation in which many, many people are illegal, and you're just saying, we shall make them legal tomorrow. And I think there's some confusion on immigration across the board. Okay, there's some people who, in any individual case, say that we should let more people in the country. And we should pick good people to be immigrants in the country, not blanket across the board. You know, we do not need people who might commit crimes, we do not need people who might take advantage of our welfare systems. Historically in this country, our immigrants have been an overall plus. I think our goal should be every immigrant a good immigrant, not sweeping across the board amnesties. And a problem with that is, well, by the way, is when you do have a sweeping across the board amnesty, you wind up with a lot of people in gray areas going before courts, and might wind up with more, I think, than was intended. But on DACA, it's not a horrible thing to say because your parents are here, because you've been here for 12 years, you don't get to be a citizen. I mean, I can think of a lot of Americans who run from time to time. They were raised abroad. Maybe their parents were missionaries. Maybe they worked for the State Department, maybe they were in the military. And they were raised outside the United States, but they always knew they were American. It wasn't a traumatic thing to come back. I think part of the problem is, too, we have over 195 countries right now. I should look, Google it, and find out exactly how many countries we have. But it's not the end of the world if some people don't live in the United States. And I think some people, when you talk to them, they always think, like, it's a horrible thing if somebody can't live in the United States. You know, a small percentage of the world lives here, and it's not the end of the, you know, like I said, it's not the end of the world that people have to go back to the country to be their citizens.
It's the end of the world if you're a teenager and you're a junior in high school, and it's all you've ever known, and suddenly you're sent back to Mexico. It's the end of the world.
Yeah, true.
These are my classmates. I know these people. I'm friends with them. It's
definitely
very
the end
unfair.
Of the world.
Totally unfair.
So you would want them deported, is what you're saying.
Depends on the individual.
Well, they've already
passed the test. They're in school. They're in the military. They're in professions.
Uh-huh.
You want them deported?
Depends on the individual.
The Pope come out against
it.
He says the family is the cradle of life.
Christ is going door to door. They're not doing individual things. That is a fact.
Yeah.
Okay.
Your policy, your thoughts are wrong, I believe. I think if we had a show of hands, you'd find that your ideas aren't good.
My husband's a legal immigrant, and he had to do a whole bunch of things to get here.
I have friends who are legal immigrants from Russia, no less.
I have a daughter-in-law who's a legal immigrant, but she has been treated with prejudice because of her accent and her color. And even though she is legal, she knows more about the United States than I bet you do.
Well, thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Sorry I wasn't here the last time we did this. We're talking about arranging another few in a couple of months. I don't know if we'll be in Fontenac County, but we'll be somewhere. Probably not in Mount Calvary, but thank you for being here.